How's everybody doing? Happy 4th of July week. We're going to stand to our feet and worship. Man, it is a privilege to worship God with all of you guys. So let's just invite God to come and have his way this morning. It's going to be a great day.
Take my worship you, Lord. There's no like you.
Your love.
Your love is strong and mighty. It's jealousy unyielding. It burns for me like a fire untamed.
Through the deepest waters. Hey! So as we're in worship, I'm just reminded of the story of the blind man in the Bible. As Jesus was coming in to town, he cried out, "Jesus!" crying out for Jesus, wanting to be healed. And the crowds told him, "No, be quiet, shut up. We don't want to hear you cry out." See, he says, "No, I'm going to cry even louder. I'm going to cry out. I'm going to give my all because I believe that Jesus can heal me." So I think just throughout the whole service beforehand, and now there's just been just a sense of victory that God wants to move in and through every one of us. So I believe right now, God will just have us cry out even louder, that don't look to your left and look to your right. Don't look to what people say, what the world says, but look to Jesus. Cry out as we press in, as we just go after him. I believe there's victory, there's freedom, and there's healing. So if the worship team would lead us back in just a time of victorious worship.
Thank you, Father. Lord, we come before you this morning, even in a week as a nation when we celebrate our independence and our freedom, Lord God, we thank you that that's nothing compared to the freedom we find in you. And Lord, even in agreement with the word given by Riley this morning, the word of victory, Lord, we thank you that for the victory that we have, Lord God, because it's in you, Lord Jesus. And this morning, we come before you. And we take our attention and our eyes off of our circumstances, our situations, whatever our troubles or problems might be, Lord. And we put our attention and our focus on you this morning because it's in you that we have victory, Lord. It's in you that we have freedom. So this week, as we celebrate our nation's freedom, we're going to more importantly celebrate our freedom in you even this morning, Lord God. We thank you, Father, for victory in our lives. We thank you for victory over sin, Lord God. We thank you for the victory that we find in you. And this morning, Father, if there's anyone here that who hasn't experienced that victory yet, I pray even in this moment that you would begin to touch their hearts, Lord God, and that you would meet them where they are, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Father, for this morning. I thank you for this awesome time of worship. We pray that you would be lifted high, God. It's not about us and what we can do. It's not about what our situations or circumstances are presenting, but more importantly, it's about you and what you can do in them, Lord God. We praise you, Father. We thank you for this morning. We thank you for this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning, Joy Church. How are you? Awesome. Well, you may be seated. If this is your first time here to Joy Church Medford, we are so excited that you are here. But we have one request. This is very important to us. We want to make sure that you meet someone here from the family and community here at Joy Church Medford. There's a few ways you can do that. And the first is just stopping by the connection table out in the foyer, saying hi to somebody and getting some information. They're going to get some information from you. If you can't do that, maybe you have to slip out early. All we want you to do is fill out a connect card, a welcome card. It should be at the pew right in front of you. Pick it up, fill it out, drop it in the offering bucket, and we will make sure to go out of our way to properly welcome you here to the family at Joy Church Medford. If you have yet to get involved in a connect group, connect groups are the lifeblood here at Joy Church Medford. They are so important to us. It's simple. It's a Bible study that happens for you. There's one for your age group and your demographic. Unfortunately, this week's not a connect week, but next week is. So you have time to find a connect group to get involved in and be there next week because next week's a connect group. If you want more information on that, just stop by the information booth and we'll give you information because that's what information booths are for, right? This Wednesday, July 5th, unfortunately, we will not be having service this week, but it's for a good reason. We want to make sure you have time to get refreshed and spend with your family, have a great 4th of July week, and come back Sunday energized, refreshed, and ready to serve and commune with your church family. So this Wednesday, there will not be service, but it's for a good reason. That is, we want you to get refreshed with your family and enjoy the 4th of July holiday. And speaking of family, I've said that word a few times. We have a family fun day coming up July 30th, directly following service. We're going to go to Immigrant Lake. It's only $4 per car for an awesome day of fun. All we ask is that you bring your own main dish to eat and a side dish to share. It's going to be a great time. You do not want to miss out on our family fun day. And CYM's youth camp is coming up August 14th. Through the 18th, it's $230 per student, and you can get signed up. We have a special youth camp table in the foyer, so go out there and get signed up. Now, if you want to get involved in some fundraising opportunities, maybe you can't make all the funds, then you're absolutely welcome to do that. We have a lot of opportunities that you can find out about at that booth. But if you are a parent of a student who's going to use the fundraising opportunities, we ask that you as a parent also get involved. And there's a few ways you can do that, with transportation or helping at some of the fundraising booths around town. So please, if you're going to have your child help fundraise, make sure that you become a part of that as well. Today, Growth Track is launching in week number one. Growth Track is awesome. It's the best way to get plugged in here at Joy Church. This week, the focus is connecting to God. Now, on our Growth Track, it's a 4-week cycle, and you can jump in on any week. But the best week to jump in is week one, and week one starts today. So if you're thinking about joining the Growth Track, you should absolutely do that. Today is the best time to get started. In fact, we have a special little video to promote our Growth Track right now.
Hello, Joy Church. We are so excited about a brand new class we're launching called the Growth Track. This is a 4-week class that will take place every Sunday following service. Lunch will be provided as well as childcare. Whether you've been a part of Joy for 1 week or the past year, this is your perfect next step. There's 4 key topics that we're going to be looking at. The first is how to connect to God better. The second is how you can connect to Joy Church and get more involved. The third is how you can discover your purpose and the giftings that God has given you. And lastly, you'll be looking at how to find your place and join the Joy Church Dream Team. This truly is a great next step for you to join the Growth Track here at Joy Church.
I've had this song going through my head the last few days. It goes something like this. An old DC Talk song says, "What if I stumble and what if I fall?" Anyways, I'll kind of leave the singing to the professionals. I bring that song up because, as many of you guys know, February 26, I took a little slip, and I've been on this little journey of healing. And as you guys know, I'm a tough guy. I can, like, I'll just kind of bear with it and walk through it. And as many guys are, we're just going to just, yeah, I could do this. I can handle this on my own. But I found out that this one I couldn't handle on my own. I had to go see some doctors and get MRIs and do all that stuff, and that's when they told me, "You're not so tough, buddy." And when the doctor said, "Unless you follow this surgery and this prescribed treatment, you're gonna be crippled the rest of your life." And that was enough for me. I thought, whatever you need to do, whatever procedure you need to do, whatever the cost, I'm 56 years old, in 4 years I'm gonna be reaching the prime of my life. I need to be strong. I need full motion. And but for me, it's like I want to go on in full strength. The problem I see as a leader at Joy is people come into the house of God, and there's times when they stumble, and there's times when they fall, and there's times when they hurt themselves, and yet they say, "I can handle this on my own." And God has placed leaders in your life to where you can go to them and say, "Listen, I've screwed up and I've hurt myself." And oftentimes the prescribed treatment can be painful. It can take some time, right? And you would do well to listen, because there's people that are trained in the Word of God. They're trained in the things of God. They have experience. The doctor that I have that's working with me right now, even with all the technological advances, he has experience. He's got an ear to hear, and he knows there's certain things that he just has to look for and hear. We have some doctors in the house now that understand what I'm talking about, that even the technology can't replace experience. And this is one of the things that happens in the house of God. You have experience. You have people that are trained. And one of the things that we're told in Galatians, we're going to turn there in Galatians 6:6, it says, those who are taught the word of God should provide for their teachers, sharing all good things with them. God has ordained, he set up the system. You have people that are teachers, and you have people that need to be taught. That's the way God set it up. Yeah? Or would you say that you're coming into this place week after week, you're saying, no, I've learned all I need to learn, I've heard all I need to hear, and I think I could take this and do the rest of this on my own. You know, I've been coming to this church since February 1987, and I suspect that even today that I'm going to learn something new. I come to the house of God expecting to learn something new. Well, what does this have to do with offering? Turn to Galatians 6:10, please. In Galatians 6:10, it says, therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should be good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. We have invested thousands, even tens of thousands of dollars into the house of God, probably pushing $100,000 over our time here. If I was to go back and do the math, it's been a long time. We have invested, and I would say that it has been a good investment, Pastor Steve. It's been a good investment. You know what? When I came into this place, Jan can attest to this, I was a total dunce. I didn't know squat. She said, I'm not far from that now. It's not permanent. So I come into the house of God. Why would you come into the house of God and say, you know what? I don't think I want to invest a penny into God's house because I'm going to handle this on my own. I don't know, man. My kids, they need training in the house of God. But don't worry about it. You guys do it on your own. We don't need to invest. I'm just telling you. I'm going to share something with you from my friend Matthew Henry, and then I'll be done if you got just a moment. Matthew Henry is a good buddy of mine. We go way back. It is the duty of those who are taught in the word to support those who are appointed to teach them. For they are to communicate to them in all good things freely and cheerfully, to contribute of the good things in which God has blessed them, what is needful for their comfortable subsistence. See, even over the years, it's just been expected that you come and you give in the house of the Lord. You give. You invest. For me, there's been times when my soul was hurting. Pastor, I need help. I need help. Can you help me through? Thank God. Pastor was here. You have connect group leaders. You have teachers in the house. You have youth pastors. You have elders, people that care for your soul. There's many of you guys in this place that Jan and I have prayed for you. You don't even know this, that we have prayed for you and all the other elders and pastors that prayed for you. There's tragedies that you have missed because of the prayers of the saints in your lives. It's worth investing in, don't you think? Amen. Go ahead, ushers.
Before we pray for the offering, we're going to thank the Lord for the offering, but today is Call to Fall Sunday, which there's a whole organization called Call to Fall, and I didn't sign us up to be officially one of their churches, but I think that we should take a moment or a couple of minutes and let's thank God for the republic that we live in. Amen. How many have ever been to the United States? Okay. Did you know that many people who live in the United States have no clue what makes our republic so different, where we can still preach the gospel in the streets? We can still peacefully convene. And God is doing something in America. Amen. Don't, you know, abortion is less popular than ever before. Many people, I've heard people say the church did nothing to war against abortion. The church resisted it when it was sneaked up on the church, and the church, from the time that abortion was made legal in the United States by fiat declaration of the Supreme Court, the church has always resisted it. Right. I think it's easy to throw stones at the institutional church, the one that Jesus loves. That's what Danny was talking about. I want to pray for our nation. I want to bless our president. Amen. I want to pray that news is news. Amen. I want to pray that justice and liberty, the things that the Bible teaches, which our republic attempted to have from its foundation on. I say attempted because it's human people, and human people need God's help, don't we? We try to have liberty and justice and freedom and good things in our family. If we can't even get it right all the time, and I don't, even at a family level, I think I need to give my president, whether it's Barack Obama or President Donald J. Trump, I need to give him my prayer, not my criticism. So if you would maybe lean up to the pew right in front of you, if everyone leans forward rather than get down on our knees, let's just take a moment. Come kneel with me here, George.
Right.
Father, we are falling on our knees in our heart. We thank you for the convention in July 4th, 1776. Only in America do we celebrate the day we determined to get free. It's because you put an optimism in this nation. Come, Holy Spirit, flow in this nation. Touch our nation. Bless the Supreme Court of the United States. Bless the President. Bless the House of Representatives. Bless the Senate. Bless the state governors across this nation. And I pray, Lord, that you would heal us. Forgive us of our guilt. We have many national sins, but our Savior is greater than our sins. We pray, Lord, that you would show your mercies, pour out your mercies on this nation. Lord, help it start with us as individuals. Lord, let this year from July 2nd till this time next year, Lord, let there be trackable progress that we have with you, Lord, that those around us say something's going on in their life. Lord, help us to not sin by failing to pray for our leaders. Thank you, God. Bless this nation. Lord, and the ones we cry out for even the most are the lost that are blinded in their sins, we pray, Lord, that revival would touch this nation once again. Great sweeping yearning to come to the living God. Thank you, Father. We pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, one prayer done. Thank you, Father, for your goodness. Thank you for your blessing. We bless this offering and its use. Thank you for your prosperity. We live in it, Lord. You're so gracious to us. Not only as a church, but as families, as individuals.
Yes,
we bless this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, I want to introduce, Children's Church is dismissed, by the way. Okay. Oh, by the way, we're all here today. All of us that are here, and those that are out camping, Lord, we pray that the fleas would attack their dog right now. We've been camping up at Lost Creek, and we got up, and all of us, you know, real believers, we took our showers at 6 and came down the hill. And some of our camp is up there. Dogs, I'm going to get them. I'm going to put something bad in their bratwurst tonight. You know what I'm saying? But seriously, it's so good to be together in the house of the Lord. About 10 years ago, my good buddy, Jeff Strickland, called me up and he said, "Hey, I've got this really neat guy named Mike Silva who's an evangelist, and he would be interested in meeting you," which probably he lied, probably Jess lied. So Jess brought Mike Silva, and Mike Silva is an evangelist, and now Mike Silva's a part of our organization, MFI. So Mike and Crystal are here today, and when I first met Mike, I go, he's the first person I like more than Jess. And that's, Jess is so likable when you meet him, but Mike was even prettier and nicer and dances better. And so we didn't really stay in touch a lot during that 10 years. I think occasionally we'd have a shout out or something. But Mike and Crystal are here, and they've been living up in the high desert near and sisters, and they're doing conferences and things again. So we're going to take about 3 or 4 minutes or whatever it will be. The best way to introduce Mike is just so you can see a little bit of what he and Crystal are up to. And then Mike's going to greet us and share with us, and we're going to be motivated. And guess what? We're going to have a better 4th of July than all those others. Let's watch this video if we could.
Passionate festivals and legacy is what we do. They all work together. We've been able to find and secure wells that have stopped functioning, but they're still sweet water. So we're able to refurbish them for a fraction of the cost that it would take to initially drill them. There's something about a fresh water well that quenches the thirst of generation after generation. When we take care of people like that and invite them to the festival, life changes. Keep in mind, the purpose of our festival is not to reach people in the church. Our heart is that of Almighty God's, to reach those that are outside His church. The festival platform is a platform that God has given us, uses and blesses to be able to reach those not yet convinced with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Most of the time, they walk up and they stay. They're intrigued, they love the music, and they hear the gospel and their lives are transformed. I wish you could see what I see. I wish you could be right there on the platform and see it when a heart is opened, broken, receptive, and the seed of the gospel drops and takes first root.
La palabra de Dios dice, hoy es el día de salvación. ¿Por qué hoy? Porque posiblemente no tengas un mañana. Por ejemplo, mi padre murió en un accidente automovilístico cuando era muy joven. Fue inesperado. Por lo tanto, les ruego, hoy mismo clama a Jesús.
Solo Cristo nos perdona y nos limpia de todo pecado. Solo Jesucristo salva.
The Bible clearly says, and I live by, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Why? Because it is the power of God to change and transform men and women and young people, grandparents, children to this day. If we could just reach out to those with growling stomachs, thirsty mouths, invite them to a festival, life is changed, then those people become the next generation. I'm always looking for the people like myself in countries overseas. You know the kind I'm talking about. The fatherless ones like me. No name, no pedigree, no red carpets. Just passionate about proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ. Because when I think about the world that we live in, when I think about our very own country, my heart breaks. And I don't know what else we can do. I don't have the resource, neither do you, to feed the entire world, to inoculate the entire world, to take care of the needs of the entire world, to bring peace to the entire world. So therefore, what can I do? What could I do? Answer, I can't do everything, but I can do something. I can look for the next generation. I can pass the seed of the gospel. I can proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Why? So that my generation, so that my children's children, and my children's children's children would be the legacy of the gospel of Jesus Christ around the world. This is what we do.
God bless you guys so much. Come on up, Mike, and let's give him a great Southern Oregon welcome, he and Crystal.
Thank you. Thank you. Love you too, man. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, it's so great. It's been a dream for us to get to meet Pastor Jerry and Jamie, and here they are. And we follow them on Facebook. We're hearing the great things that they're doing. They're probably exhausted right now. They have had dozens and dozens of missions teams with them. And so we really need to love them up and bless them in the name of the Lord. So one more time, would you just extend your hands towards them? Just extend your hands toward them. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray that you would do in the city of La Paz a great work. Holy Spirit, take up real estate in that city in an ever-increasing way. We declare victory and joy so that La Paz would be the first city in Mexico that belongs 100% to Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord, we pray. Amen. 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 We love Pastor Steve. Actually, we love Kim, and we love Pastor Steve as well, but he's a little crazy sometimes, isn't he? And that's why we love him so much. But we count it a great privilege to be able to be here. And this is one of the few places that I'm able to come, and there's other people that speak Portuguese. That's a wonderful thing for me. Que prazer estar aqui em Medford, porque agora eu posso falar português. Então, que prazer, que prazer. E com a gente que habla espanhol, estou estudando seu hermoso idioma também. Então, que prazer estar com Pastor Kim e Pastor Steve. I want to give you a little Bible story today that I hope encourages your heart. And happy 4th of July. I hope this is just a great little break for you guys, and that you just rejoice in, as Pastor Steve said, in all that the Lord is doing. If you have your Bible, take it and turn to 2 Samuel 9, beginning in verse 1. 2 Samuel 9, beginning in verse 1. I want to also, as you're turning there, sweetheart, eu quero presentar minha esposa Cristal. Crystal, pode ficar em pé, por favor. This is my wife, Crystal. We have four daughters. Can you just welcome her to joy? And trust me, living with me, we just celebrated June 4th, our 40th anniversary. So if this woman needs anything, she needs to have joy. Joy Church, yeah, you need to be a joy. We've got four great girls, and we are so blessed. You know what, you guys? If we did not know Pastors Steve and Kim, if we did not know them, if all someone said to us is, did you know that all of their children serve Jesus, love Jesus? Then I would think they're my heroes no matter what. Isn't that the truth? And it's a great joy. It's a great joy. We both were thinking the same thing, and thank God for kids like that. 2 Samuel, okay, let's do a little Bible study here. 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1. One day, David, let's read verse 1 and see if there's anything we can pull there from 2 Samuel chapter 9 and verse 1. One day, David, that's King David, of course you know, one day David began wondering, watch this, if anyone in Saul's family was still alive. Okay, stop. One day, David. Biblical scholars tell us Excuse me. Biblical scholars tell us that David had been on the throne as the king of Israel for about 15 years. So think back. Has anybody had anything happen 15 years ago? Anybody, you were married 15 years ago? You graduated from high school 15 years ago? Anybody have anything happen about 15 years ago significant that you can think of? So there were things in your life. Well, King David had been on the throne for about 15 years. Here's what that says to us. That says that he was no longer a rookie king. That says that he had time to kind of get things set the way he wanted them set, to set the course of the nation. He established his leadership. So now it's 15 years later. So about 15 years later, David begins wondering. Stop. I ask myself, church, this question. Did David wonder on purpose or did he wonder by accident? Because I believe that everyone that walks with Almighty God, that knows God, that has a heart, like the scripture says about David, David had a heart for God. Here's another way to say it in New Testament times, in the age of grace. When we carry the Holy Spirit of God inside of us, I believe that when we wonder, we are wondering on purpose and not by accident. So David is in his place where he rules. There, it's been about 15 years, and he begins to one day wonder, and I believe, since the scripture says in Genesis, in the very beginning of the book, the Holy Spirit was around. Sometimes the church believes, oh no, the Holy Spirit wasn't even born until Acts chapter 2. Not true. Not true. And so the Holy Spirit, even there, I believe that the Holy Spirit is the one that began to, on purpose, bring to remembrance into the mind of King David this thought. I wonder if anyone in Saul's family was still alive. For he had promised Jonathan, remember, Jonathan was his great friend. In fact, what a paradox. Because every one of us have great friends and every one of us have great enemies. Saul was his great enemy and Jonathan was his great friend. And so he says, I wonder if there's anyone in Saul's family is still alive. For he had promised Jonathan that he would show kindness to any of them. Wow. Church, let me just ask you this. Do you just wonder about showing kindness to your enemies or to the families of your enemies? I don't tend to. But yet David had so much integrity, he wanted to show kindness to Saul's family, his number one enemy. I want to show kindness to them. You know, that kind of integrity is attractive, is it not? I mean, when we can be around people, businesses, individuals, churches, men, women, students that have integrity like that, there's something magnetic about that. And David was that kind of individual. So he summoned a man named Ziba. I love that name. Next dog I get, I want to name him Ziba. Wouldn't that be a good name? Ziba. Ziba. Isn't that a good name? Ziba, who had been one of Saul's servants. Are you Ziba? The king asked. Yes, sir, I am, Ziba replied. Then the king asked him, is anyone still alive from Saul's family? If so, watch this. I want to show kindness to them any way that I can. Church, what a picture of not only David's integrity, but this is beginning to show us a picture of God's grace. Because grace is what you get when you don't even deserve it. I remember the last traffic ticket I got. And after you do the, please give me your operator's license, your registration, your insurance card, and blah, 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 blah. And they go to their car, and they punch in on their computer in there. Boop, 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 boop. By the way, church, you know that law enforcement, once they do that, they know more about you than you know about you at that moment. Can anybody relate to me on that one? So then the officer comes back, and he says, okay, so here's what you did. Do you have any questions? And I thought, thought to myself, I may be able to use this as an illustration or an example someday in speaking. So I said to him, as I looked up at him out of my vehicle, and I said to him, you don't feel gracious today, do you? To which he responded, no, sir, I feel just. See, church, that's the difference between God's grace and justice. Justice is when we get exactly what we deserve. Bump the person next to you and say, thank God for his grace. Go ahead. Thank God for his grace. Thank God for his grace. Okay. So then the scripture says this, yes, I'm Ziba, and he wants, so Ziba replied, yes, there is one individual that's alive, it's one of Jonathan's son is still alive, but, watch this, but he's crippled. And to me, if you look at it in like a 3D perspective, it almost seems as though Ziba is telling the king of Israel, yes, there is one of Saul's family, it's Jonathan's son, but I can almost hear the king say, but what, young man? But he's say it, what is, what? He's crippled. Implication: whatever you're thinking about doing, he may not be qualified. Men and women, have you ever thought to yourself, I don't qualify for God's grace? You see, I'm spiritually crippled, Denny. You see, I've got a past, and because of my past, I don't. Do you ever feel like you don't qualify for this free gift called God's grace? I'm sure that this individual did. And so King David, not being affected whatsoever by the fact that the young man was crippled, by the way, he found out that he was crippled before he found out his name. So then he says in verse 4, where is this individual, the king asked. And the scripture says, in Lodabar, Ziba said, at the home of Machir, son of Amiel. So David sent for him and brought him from Machir's home. Okay, watch this. Have you done research to find out what Lodabar means? Do you know that Lodabar, in Hebrew, Lodabar means pastureless? Lodabar means barren. Lodabar means desolate. Desolate. And so here is this son of the king of Israel, Saul, the grandson of the king of Israel when Saul was the king. The king's son, the prince, Jonathan, his son, and he's living in a pastureless, dry, another thing we could say in our culture today, he's living in a desert, out in the desert, in a desolate, desolate place. Why would the ex-king's grandson be living in a desolate place? The prince's son live in a desolate place. Answer, because you all know, let me just rehearse or refresh your memory about biblical times and culture. When a king was no longer king, when he was removed, before the next king, when the next king became in the position of power and sat on the throne, they executed every one of the king's family so that there would never be a time when the ex-royal family could ever come back on the current reigning family to cause a problem. So this young man, Jonathan, Prince Jonathan's son, runs away to save his own life, and he lives in this pastureless, desolate place called Lodabar. And then it hit me. You know, we could have some people here at Joy today that are feeling like spiritually you're living in a desolate place. Spiritually, you're feeling dry. Spiritually, you're feeling like I'm in a pastureless, non-fruit-producing season. Then I came to tell you today, there is hope for you, because it changed here in the scripture, it's changed in my life, and it can change for you. So David sent for him, Sersano,
In Spanish, that means be healed. Ser sano. So David sent for him, and brought him from Machir's home. Okay, his name was, now we learn it, his name was Mephibosheth. That would be another good name. I think Mephibosheth would be a good name for a cat. I like Ziba for a dog, Mephibosheth for a cat. And he was Jonathan's son and Saul's grandson. I still have to ask you, men and women, do you just make it a practice like King David wanted to do to be kind to Saul, King Saul's grandson? Do you think to yourself, what can I do to bless my enemy and my enemy's family? I just tend to not act like that. I just tend to not think like that. And the thought came to my mind, and I wanted to share it with you. Could it be possible that there is a biblical principle here that may go something like this? If I would bless my enemies, Almighty God may bless me. Could that be possible? That if I would begin to bless my enemies, that Almighty God may be one that would bless me. So the scripture goes on to say, but David said, so they brought him in, and when he came to King David, he bowed low in great fear, and he said, I am your servant. I thought to myself, what is the New Testament principle there? Would it not be what the scripture says? Help me with this verse. If I humble, so here's Mephibosheth. He comes in. He sees the king. You can see him crippled. Either two men on either side carrying him, or some kind of crude crutch or something, crutches that he had to be able to move and walk on, because this man was crippled. Do you remember why he was crippled? Any nannies in here? Professional nannies? Do you remember that the nanny, do you remember it was the day, it was on Mount Gilboa, when Mephibosheth's grandfather, King Saul, died, his father, Prince Jonathan, died. The scripture says in 2 Samuel 4 that Mephibosheth was 5 years old. When his nanny heard that his father and his grandfather were dead, she picked him up and began to run out of the palace to hide him, afraid for their lives. And she tripped, dropped Mephibosheth as a 5-year-old little boy. Biblical scholars say it was probably some kind of spinal injury that crippled him for the rest of his life. So is the story, isn't this, bump the person next to you and say, I love the Bible. Is it great? I mean, some people say, you know, the Bible is boring, irrelevant, and all that stuff. To me, it is just, it talks about everything under the sun. The Bible talks about lust and sex and gambling and money and pride and politics and murder and runaways and gangs. And I mean, it's all here in the book, and I just love it. Anyway, so he falls before the king. Here's the New Testament principle. He falls in humility. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. He will lift you up. Here's another way to say that, church. As we think of our relationship with Almighty God, my Crystal and I thought about it today, seeing those little boys right here, and several of them on their knees, one of them covered his head. And I thought to myself, just this morning, humility, when it comes to my relationship with him, humility before God, watch this, it is absolutely irresistible, humility. If you ever want to know how you can please God, get humble real fast. Because humility is absolutely irresistible to Almighty God. Well, then the scripture goes on to say this. He says, don't be afraid. So David says to him, when he bows low before him in great fear and said, I'm your servant. And David said, do not be afraid. And then I thought, you see how long it takes me to read scripture? These thoughts keep coming to my mind. David says, the king says, do not be afraid. Do you know the biblical scholars say that there are at least 365 do not be afraids in the Bible? That's one for every day. Do you struggle with fear like I struggle with fear? 365 times. There's at least there are those words in the scripture, do not be afraid, do not be afraid, do not be afraid. So if you struggle with fear like I do, may the word of God empower and infuse you today. There it is. Do not be afraid. And then I thought to myself, wow, here's the King of Israel saying to the grandson and the son of Prince Jonathan, who is crippled and hiding and afraid for his life and crippled the rest of his life, and he's so afraid that he's being called to the king, so he was thinking maybe the king is going to murder me. He falls before his face. He says, oh, king, I'm your humble servant. I'm your servant. And the king speaks a very short, powerful message. Do not be afraid. Church, and the thought came to my mind, do you know that's the same message that our king still gives today? The king's message remains. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Look at the person next to you and say, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. I don't know where you are. I don't know what you're going through, but I would say to you, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Then he says this, I've asked you to come here so that I can be kind to you because of my vow to your father, Jonathan. Can you imagine what Mephibosheth's face looked like? What? Church, the only person that knew about that covenant between David and Jonathan was David and Jonathan, and one of them's dead. How does Mephibosheth know anything about that covenant? Answer, he didn't. But it was the integrity of the king that said, I promised your daddy that I would take care of you, of his family, and you're the only one left, and I'm making good on my word after 15 years later since I've been the king. Can you imagine that kind of integrity? So Mephibosheth, you can imagine his face. David says this, because of the vow I made to your father. And he says, I'm going to give you. Church, that's a picture of grace. You don't have to buy it. You don't have to earn it. I'm a first generation believer. I'm a first generation believer. I'm actually a first generation American. Robert, to my Portuguese buddy here, my father was born on the boat from the Azores headed for Ellis Island, New York. So my father didn't have a country, legally didn't have a country that he belonged to. So I am a first generation Christian and a first generation North American. I thought to myself as I read that, I'm going to give you all of the land that once belonged to your grandfather Saul, that you may live there with me. I thought to myself, you know, you don't have to earn it. You don't have to buy it. You don't have to win it in the lotto. The King David said, I'm going to give it to you. Church, that's a picture of grace. Are you in a position today where you would say, Father, I need some more grace. I need a touch from you. Listen, I can't buy it. I can't work for it. I want you to give it to me. And God says, I'm in the business of giving God's grace. I'm in the business of giving God's grace. So Mephibosheth, he says, I'm not only going to give you all of this, but I want you to live here with me at the palace. I want you to live here with me at the palace. Church, in this society and culture, did it get better than living in the palace? Did it get better than that? Mephibosheth then fell with his face to the ground again. Should the king, watch this. Should the king show such kindness to a dead dog like me? Have you ever felt that way? God, if you only knew how I was, can you imagine the created saying to the creator, if you only knew how I was, if you only knew who I am, if you only knew what I've done. God says, I know all of that. Get past that. I know all of that. And I want to give you this gift. I want to give you this gift. Ziba, who had 15 sons and 20 servants, replied, "Yes, Lord, I'll do all that you've commanded." And from that time on, Mephibosheth ate regularly with David as though he were one of the king's sons. You know, so basically, when David gave this charge and said, "Mephibosheth, I'm going to give you everything that belonged to your to the ex-king of Israel, your grandfather and your father, I'm going to give you all that. And on top of all of that, Ziba and all of his sons and all of his relatives and all of his resources are going to farm the land and give you the money. And so that I make sure all of your expenses are covered, you're going to live and dine with me here in the palace." So here's what that says to me. That says to me that when you believe, you belong. Can you imagine if Mephibosheth would have said, "King, I'm hearing what you're saying, but I don't believe you." And if he would have left to go back to Lodabar or left to go somewhere else. But see, church, when you believe, you belong. I'm so glad you're here, and I'm so glad you belong to a fellowship like this. I'm so glad that you believe in Almighty God and who He is and what He's promised. When the scripture says there, I thought it was such a great thing. When the scripture says there, "King, how could you be gracious to a God, to a dead dog like me? We have all felt inadequate. We have all felt like we don't deserve any of this." But guess what we have to remember? When your home is on fire, who in this country, in this culture, when your home is on fire, what do you qualify for? Fire department. When there's an auto accident and people are laying out in the highway or the streets, what do you qualify for? Paramedics. And for men and women, spiritually speaking, when we feel like dead dogs before the King of the universe, the creator of the world, we feel like dead dogs, guess what we qualify for? The King's grace. Yeah. It's the same message today as it was here. We qualify because we are, if we were honest with ourselves, we are spiritually dead dogs, and the grace of God just flows out on us. And then he says, from this time on, Mephibosheth ate regularly with David as though he were one of the king's sons. I've often thought to myself, you know, if I would have been born with a silver spoon in my mouth, how would I have been? How would I be? If I grew up on red carpets, how would I be? How would that have affected me? And then it hit me, wow, I guess I know. Because I am a son of the Most High God. And because I'm a son of the Most High God, I get the palace, I get him, I get his resources, I get his future, I get his presence, I get everything that he has to offer. So even though I wasn't physically born into that, I have spiritually inherited everything that Almighty God has to offer to us. So now I know what it's like to live as one of the king's very own sons. So Mephibosheth had a young son named Micah. And from then on, all the members of Ziba's household were Mephibosheth's servants. And Mephibosheth was crippled in both feet. Notice how they say that again? Crippled in both feet. He moved not only to Jerusalem, to this gorgeous, beautiful palm tree oasis place, this wonderful place where the temple was. He not only moves there, but he moves in to live in the palace. I think that is my greatest need, church, in life, is God's grace. And Mephibosheth got it. Let me give you just a couple of little applications for us to put in our pocket and take home about this passage. And here's number one. God is always active amongst us. Watch this. Even when we don't see it or recognize it or feel it or hear it. I promise you, God is active in your life today. You might say, "Yeah, but I don't, but I don't see anything." Then that has something to do with your spiritual eyes and not the activity of God. "Yeah, but I don't feel anything about God." Then that has something to do with your spiritual sensory system. It has nothing to do with God. Are you with me? "But I don't hear. I don't hear. I, I don't hear God doing anything. Then that has something to do with your spiritual hearing. It has nothing to do with God. Because my promise to you is Almighty God is active, moving, working all the time. Here's the next one. When God's grace falls on us, listen, it takes our breath away. I want that. Can you imagine when Mephibosheth fell before King David of Israel? And he said, "Oh, King, I'm your servant, I'm your servant." And David said, I can imagine David said to his aides, "Pick him up." And when he picked up and looked at the king, he said, "Do not be afraid. I'm going to make good on my vow that I made to your father." Can you imagine how he must have felt? I think it took his breath away. And God's grace is like that here, and it's like that here today. Joy Church, what I have known about Joy Church for these last years, Joy Church is a grace place. Joy Church is a grace place where it is received regularly and flows freely. Here's the next one. Whoever, whatever, wherever, God's grace will find you. Even if you're in a desolate place, even if you live in a pastureless season, whoever you are, even if you are crippled, even if you are banged up, even if you are whoever, whatever, whenever, God's grace will find you like it found Mephibosheth, like it found me. And every one of us have a story about what you were doing and the direction you were going, and then God. And that's what happened with Mephibosheth. I think basically as we look at this passage, David's kindness to Mephibosheth. David's kindness to Mephibosheth, church. I think if there was a sermon in a sentence about this passage, it would simply be this. David's kindness to Mephibosheth is simply a picture of God's grace. It's a picture of God's graciousness to you and to me and to our children and our children's children. It's a picture. The king who had everything gave to the man who had nothing everything he had. Had in his storehouse. And the king of your heart does the very same thing. I'm going to ask you to stand with me if you would, please. And I'm just going to ask you today, if there would be someone here that would say, I want God's grace in my life, maybe for the first time, but for some others of you, maybe you would say, I want a new touch. I'm kind of living, spiritually speaking, I'm living in Lodabar right now. And you would like to just come, and by coming, you're going to say, I want that fresh touch of God's grace. If he's given it, I want to accept it. You know what I thought was so amazing, church? When the scripture says over and over here, David, you are going to sit at my table. You are going to eat at my table. Did your mind go here yet? When Mephibosheth, who is crippled, as the scripture says, in both feet, when Mephibosheth sat at the king's table, there was no deformity. There was no, what do you call that word? Indicator would be a word. Disability. When Mephibosheth was sitting at the king's table, no disability was visible. I want that. I want that. Sit at the table. No disability is visible. If you want to come this morning and say, Pastor Mike, I got to get me a little bit of God's grace. I'm just in a season. I'm in a zone. I'm in a desolate place. I'm in Lodabar, spiritually speaking. And I just want to pray for God's touch. I just want to pray for a fresh touch. Then I'm going to ask you to come. And while you're coming, if you're here and you would say this, listen, I don't know for sure that I know Jesus. I don't know. Maybe you're here. Listen, the whole world is on vacation and camping today. But if you're here because somebody invited you to be here, if you're here and that's your circumstance and you would say, I'm not sure I've ever tasted the King of the Universe's grace like that before, then I want you to know you come and we want to show you how you can know that. Listen, watch this. There is nothing as sweet as tasting the grace of God. There is nothing like that. And you don't have to work for it, pay for it. All you got to do is accept the, watch this, accept the invitation and sit at the table. And wherever you are, whatever you are, whoever you have been, nothing will be visible. There are no disabilities visible when you're seated at the table. Anyone like that? Si usted está aquí y tú quieres hablar con alguien en español, tenemos latinos aquí para hablar con ti en español. Entonces venga, por favor, queremos orar por ti ahora mismo. Entonces, Pastor Steve, please, you come.
For those of you that are receiving Jesus, we want to just pray a prayer that we pray week after week, which is asking the Lord to come into our life. We call it joining God. God has done everything that He could possibly do to join us, but the last thing that He requires of us is to believe, to call. The Bible said, if you call on the name of the Lord, you'll be saved. So we're going to say that prayer, and let's all pray it together. And if you are praying that for the first time, come down, talk to the prayer team, and they'll help you get set up with some training, Bible studies. Also, after service, in about 15 minutes, we'll be having some lunch for those of you who are interested in the growth track, and you'll also be getting instruction on how to connect with God. But let's just pray this prayer. Dear Father, I thank you for that grace that Mike was preaching about. We see Jesus as the Son of David. And just as David reached out to save, so Jesus reaches out to save. Father, I acknowledge my blemishes, my sins, my disabilities, and yet your grace reaches to me. You said if I would call on your name, that I would be saved. You said that whoever calls on your name would not be ashamed. I reach out to you, Father, because I feel you reaching for me. And I say, save me now. Take away my shame. I receive you today, dear Father. And I say, if you'll be my God, I'll be your servant. If you'll be my Father, I'll be your child. I receive you today, dear Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.